Hello, this is Brother Jerry, the pastor here at Friendship Baptist Church, and you are about to watch one of our messages. I hope that during this time that you would prayerfully listen. I hope that the Lord speaks to you, that He uses this message to help you grow. I hope you're able to experience God. I hope you're able to connect with Him and connect with our church. I hope that you're able to respond to what He's doing in your life. I hope you enjoy. May the Lord bless you during this time.
Praise the Lord, church. Y'all doing all right? Good morning, good morning. Next Sunday is revival. And so when we come back, I'll be here next Sunday. But Paul Cherry will be preaching, really looking forward to some time there with revival. And so be in prayer over that. And let's rejoice in just what God's going to do over today and next week. Amen? Amen? All right, Father God, Lord, we praise you today, Lord. Lord, you're worthy of all praise. Lord, not even just from our mouths, but from all creation itself, Lord, we want to join in that to exalt the name of Jesus Christ, Lord. And Lord, I pray that as we open up your word and we sing truths from your word this morning, that you would move our hearts to more of a place of worship, that we would worship in spirit and truth, God. And Lord, that we would be moved by the mightiness, the holiness, the grandeur of who you are, God. And God, I pray that you would stir us in a way that challenges us, comforts us, and Lord, implores us into walking more obediently with you, Christ. Lord, we love you, and more than anything, Lord, again, we come to exalt the name of Jesus for his glory and to worship corporately, God. Thank you for that opportunity this morning. We give all praise to you in the name of Christ. Amen.
Well, I don't know if we ought to give you 2 weeks off or not. I don't want you to get rusty. Yeah, we don't need you to get rusty. You just keep firing like you're firing. All right, well, this is going to be our birthday song. I think.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day.
All right, well, we had some didn't come up, but I know some had a birthday.
Uh-huh, he's hiding back there in that back row.
I think he's hiding on the back row. Aww. Come on up here, buddy. I got to sing happy birthday to you. And this is going to be the Big 12, right? Yes. All right. Come on up here. I'm going to let you come up here so everybody can see you. Look how good you are, huh? Not trying to embarrass you, but see your dad back here. He don't want to do that. You want me to choke him? Do the push-ups with him? No, don't make me do the push-ups with him. You want me to put that in the view? All right. Let's sing happy birthday. Yeah, thank you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Now, you know why Mr. D. Wayne done that, right? You know why I done that? We got your dad up here singing. I'm trying to get you ready for the stage, just in case you get there. Happy birthday, buddy.
Right now, right now.
Say offering hymn, but y'all put your offering back there. So I'm just going to ask Brother Doyle Wood to lead us in a prayer this morning. Thank you. Isn't it wonderful how great our God is? I don't think we show it enough a lot of times.
Amen.
You know, our God is awesome.
Amen.
So,
when Christ shall come, with shout of acclamation, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and dare proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Thank you, Jesus.
All right, you may be seated.
All full of sin.
Father God, we just love you, Lord. Lord, we do thank you for being our almighty God, Lord. Father God, thank you for the opportunity to be free here to be worshiping with you today, Lord. Father God, we just love you so much and thank you so much for your sweet son, Jesus. In your name I pray.
Well, I think most of y'all know this next one, too.
Would y'all stand and sing with us?
Praise the Lord. Oh, I don't know about y'all, but I feel the Spirit's presence And you know, there's always a sense of the Spirit indwelling me because I'm a child of God. And I know that's true for you that are children of God. I understand that. But there's just sometimes that the Spirit just grabs a hold of you and yanks you around a little bit. Are y'all with me? Am I sounding a little too Pentecostal for you? Just a bit. I tell you, I think the Spirit moves. I think it really does. And that's one thing I love about my Pentecostal brothers and sisters is they yield to the Spirit sometimes. I know we all have our ideas of how that works and things, but you know, one thing is they respect the Spirit. And I think that's a blessing when you think about God's Spirit moving. And I hope that you feel God's Spirit in here today. Just because we're Baptists don't mean we have to just sit here and not be moved by God's Spirit. Amen. All right. Well, if you would, go ahead and turn your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. I'm really excited about today. I just feel like God's all over this morning, like I've already stated. So go ahead and turn your Bibles there. And as you get there, I'm just going to kind of give us a quick recap. You know, for the last, I don't know, a good while here, we've been going through the book of Acts. And we've been watching Paul go to all these places ever since really chapter 9. And you get a little bit of Peter. But then after that, you watch Paul in these missionary journeys. And we've looked at every, or at least the first two of those so far. And it's been exciting to watch Paul go and spread the word of God, to spread the gospel message, to see people get saved. Isn't that exciting, church? Don't you want to see that today, that when people are spreading God's word, that God is opening hearts, changing hearts, giving new hearts, and people are receiving the Lord and glorifying God? I mean, that's where I want to be. I want to be right in the midst of that, wherever that is. And so let's see that the Lord maybe just bless us with his grace to put us there. Because I have been watching Paul with you through scriptures, going place to place, seeing this happen. And we watched him go. We kind of journeyed with him in a way to this little town called Thessalonica. And it was just a brief little stay, right? Just a few couple weeks, maybe 3 weeks, maybe a little longer, but a brief stay. And in that time, they accused Paul and those with him of turning the world upside down. Said, these men that have turned the world upside down. Think about that for a moment. Turn the world upside down. So bad it got there that literally an angry mob comes about and runs them out of that place. An angry mob comes to Jason's house, beats him up, pulls him out, and Paul has to flee. I mean, that's where Paul left. And I know I'm repeating myself, but it's important that you understand that this morning. That they were there after Paul had left in intense persecution. Intense persecution, talking people dying even right there in front of them, their own brothers and sisters. Keep that in mind as we get to where we're getting at in scripture this morning. And so that happened. And then so over these last really 3 weeks, we've been looking at how Paul sent Timothy back. And Timothy comes back with the word of how they're doing. And so for the last 3 weeks, we've been looking at how Paul's encouraging them, challenging them, and comforting them in this 1 Thessalonian letter. That's where we've been. The first week we looked at that Paul was thanking God for his work and the evidence of their salvation. You remember that? How beautiful that was to see fruit from people that are saved and how that works and to rejoice in that. Then the 2 weeks ago, we looked at boldness, how Paul came to them. He talks about how he came and he says specifically, I came boldly or in boldness of our God to speak the gospel of our God. You remember that? And we encouraged us as we listened to that and were challenged by that we too would leave this place and speak boldly. I pray over the last 2 weeks that you have been doing that. I pray that the Holy Spirit has given you a little bit of that juice, a little bit of that tug, a little bit of that yanking to say, hey, speak boldly the gospel of God here. I pray that may be what God's been doing. And then last week, we saw that tough, challenging. I'm telling you, y'all could have heard a pin drop in here, right? It was so quiet. Every eyeball was on me because we were talking about something that serious. We were talking about holiness. And holiness, specifically God's holiness, and then how he calls us into being holy like he is holy and how all that works. We looked at how it's a gift from God to even get holiness, that it's God's gift that he gives us. We looked at how that in and of itself was something we were to encourage one another in. We looked at how holiness is God's will for us. And then not only is it God's will for us, but it has a lot to do with our salvation, and we obtain it by knowing God. There's the six observations right there that we looked at last week when we went through this idea of holiness. And today we come to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and we're going to get into verse 9 in just a moment. But as we get here, it's important to remember the theme that Paul is going through with this letter, because I believe, church, I truly believe if we're not careful today, when we open up God's word today, when we start reading 1 Thessalonians 4, chapter 4, verse 9, all the way to the end of chapter 5, it's a lot of verses this morning, but I believe there's a theme that God's getting at this morning. And if we're not careful, we will miss it. And if we're not careful, we'll run ourselves into speculation and be completely off the point of what God has inspired through Paul to give us this morning. So please pray right now that we would just seek the Lord. Father God, Lord, we pray that we would approach your word cautiously in a way of where we're yielding to the Spirit to hear what you would have us to yield to, Lord. God, I love this passage this morning as it is challenging and comforting, Lord. I pray that you give me boldness, Lord, because this authority that you've given, Lord, through your word is real. And I pray it speaks boldly into our lives this morning. And God, more than anything, I pray it gives us a hope that we so desperately need today, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. See, I believe the end of 1 Thessalonians is not just this part where God just wants to place a couple nuggets of truth here and a couple nuggets of truth here. Sometimes we approach the Bible that way, right? And I think, unfortunately, it's because of the way we preach it at times. It's like we get this little nugget and then this nugget's completely separate and this little nugget's complete. God's got a theme through his word. It's always a theme of restoration and his love for us. But I think when we see this in context, that's why I spent all that time repeating myself a little bit of giving you context, because what Paul is doing is he's not going in and saying, let me give you a dissertation, let me give you an essay on soteriology, which means dealing with salvation. He's not saying, okay, over here, let me give you a dissertation that deals with ecclesiology, which is talking about the way the church works. And he's not saying, right here, let me give you a dissertation of eschatology, which talks about the way Christ will return and the end times and the fulfillment of that. But if we're not careful as we read this, I believe we can get caught up in all those different ways when Paul himself is not being completely fully explanatory in all these things. What he's doing is he's given us a theme of hope, and that's what I want to get to this morning, is a hope that he's given us. And so, 1 Thessalonians, remember, the point of this is that Paul is trying to encourage, challenge, and comfort these believers that were facing persecution in a fallen world. And in turn, me and you, brothers and sisters, Paul, through the inspiration of God, is going to inspire us, comfort us, and encourage us this morning. I know he will, through God's Spirit, because we live in a fallen world today, don't we? Don't y'all need the hope of Christ today? So I pray you would be comforted by this. So bear with me as we read through this long passage, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 9. If you're there, say amen. But concerning brotherly love, you have no need that I should write to you, for you yourselves are taught by God to love one another. And indeed, you do so toward all the brethren who are in all of Macedonia. But we urge you, brethren, that you increase more and more, that you also aspire to lead a quiet life, to mind your own business, and to work with your own hands, as we commanded you, that you may walk properly toward those who are outside, and that you may lack nothing. Verse 13, but I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you should sorrow or grieve as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, which do we, church? Amen. If we believe Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Chapter 5, but concerning the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you. For you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord comes, so comes as a thief in the night. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them, as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, as they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. you are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. Listen to verse 8 very carefully. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you are doing. Before I read the rest, let me just stop on that last verse. Therefore, build up, be kind, comfort one another, and edify or build up one another, just as you are doing. Children that are in here and parents with children, you'll notice in your buckets that this verse is actually on a triangle and they're to glue it together. And I want y'all to take that and I want you to help your kids finish that and take it home and hang it up somewhere and memorize this verse. Why? Because that's part of discipling your children. Do that with your children. Show them the importance of learning God's word together. Show them the importance of walking through that with them. Amen, church? It's that verse right there. Finish with me, verse 12. And we urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. Be at peace among yourselves. And now we exhort you, brethren, warn those who are unruly, comfort the faint-hearted, uphold the weak, be patient with all, see that no one renders evil for evil to anyone, but always pursue what is good, both for yourselves and for all. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the spirit. Do not despise prophecies. Test all things. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. Now may God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, who also will do it. Brethren, pray for us. Greet all the brethren with a holy kiss. I charge you by the Lord that this epistle to be read, the one we're reading now, this epistle to be read to all the holy brethren. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. Whew. Hey, Dwayne, I'm out of breath now. Where are you at? I read all that. I know it's a lot. I usually don't read that much scripture, but I struggled saying, Lord, help me with how to present this. Because first off, I want to see what you're showing me, and then I want to be able to communicate that, and I want to figure out, Lord, how you want that done. And so I prayed, and I finally felt like the Lord has given me something this morning to go through this whole portion. So pray for me as we go through this, because this is a lot. But I pray that you see the theme, the forest more than the trees. Are you with me? I pray that you see that with me. There's a lot here, but zone in with me just for a moment on verse 8. But let us who are of the day be sober. Chapter 5, verse 8. Let us of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Comfort one another with these words. Here you see these exact same three words come up again. You remember at the beginning of Thessalonians, one of the first thing Paul says to them, he says, I thank God always. After he does his greeting, the first thing he says, I thank God always and pray for you regularly. He says, remembering, he says, your work of faith, your labor of love, and your endurance of hope. Faith, love, and hope. He says that at the very beginning, and now at the end, he's coming back to these three words. He says, put on the breastplate of faith and love, and the helmet of hope of our salvation. And what you call that in Greek is an inclusio. He's tying in everything that he's written in this letter, and he's saying, this is my theme. I want you to get it. It's a literary style of saying, this is going to tie in everything that I've been talking about. So that is the reason this morning that it is titled, the sermon is Living Out Faith, Love, and Hope Through the Gospel. Of course, in Christ, through the gospel. How we do that, I think that's Paul's calling here in all of this. And so here we are. Let's dig a little bit deeper. The first point this morning is our faith in Christ pushes us to love more and more. Isn't that true, church? That our faith in Christ should push us to love more and more. Listen to verse 9 of chapter 4. But concerning brotherly love, you have no need that I should write to you, for you yourselves are taught by God to love one another, and indeed you do so toward all the brethren who are in all of Macedonia. But we urge you, brethren, that you increase more and more, that you are also aspire to lead a quiet life, mind your own business, work with your own hands as we commanded you, that you may walk properly toward those who are outside, and that you may lack nothing. So first off, Paul encourages them on the way they're loving one another. He says, your brotherly love is encouraging. The way that you love those in the church is encouraging. Now, this shouldn't be too much of a shocker for us, because what's happening? They're being persecuted. There's outside opposition against them. Y'all know what happens when a group is opposed from the outside? They come together, don't they? And what Paul's saying is, I'm so encouraged by the way you've come together, that you've really loved one another. He says, there's no need that I even write to you concerning this, because you do it as almost as if you were taught by God himself. This may be one of the most precious compliments in all of Scripture. He says, you love as if you were taught by God. Oh, church, may that be us today. May that be said of friendship when someone walks in here, or more importantly, when someone walks into friendship that's outside of this building. Whether you're scattered in the marketplace, or Walmart, Brookshire's, whether you're scattered into school where you work or the hospital, wherever it is that you are scattered, when people see friendship, because that's who you are when you belong to a body of believers, when people see friendship, you in Christ, do they say, wow, they loved me as if God taught them how to love? Oh, I pray that that would be the example that we set. When you love people, make sure you are recognizing this important truth, that people are connecting the way you love with what God says on how to love and how we are to love. May that be said of us. I pray that it's so dense in the way we love that it's almost as if God himself, if Christ himself walked through those doors, came in here, taught a whole lecture on how to love, gave us practicums, worked with us for 6 months, and then he says at the end, I've taught you how to love. Would that be us? He does give us that instruction. It's in his word. Would we love that way? As if people would say they're taught by God to love. But then Paul challenges them. In verse 10, he says, okay, you're doing it. I'm encouraged that you're doing it. But I challenge you, I urge you, I challenge you to do it even more, to increase more and more. So he says, you're doing good. You're loving one another. But do it even more, he says. And then verse 11 and verse 12, he comes to a reason for this. Not only are they to love those in the church, but he talks about challenging them to love those outside the church. He says, in a sense, that we are to love those so that, you see that in verse 12, that, or so that you may walk properly toward those who are outside. Outside what? The church, the lost is what it's talking about here. Paul's saying, may you live in such a way when someone sees you outside of here, that they see that you're loving and compassionate as if Christ himself taught you. And you know, love comes from God, doesn't it? Doesn't 1 John 14 talk about how love is God, how God is love, and how love is of God? It actually says, beloved, let us love one another, for the love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. And so what Paul's saying is, I know you're born of God. I know you know God because of the way that you are loving one another. But boy, do we struggle with loving each other sometimes. Amen? Let's just be honest this morning. There's no sense of hiding. There's no sense of just acting any other way. Let's be honest. We struggle with loving one another. I think we have this kind of idea that we will love someone as long as they meet up to my expectations. I think that's how we think sometimes. We kind of love and we expect to get some kind of acknowledgement or appreciation for that love, right? And so when we love someone and they don't even acknowledge it or appreciate it, I ain't loving that person no more. Waste of my time. That's how we are. I know it. I'm right there with you. Or we say, okay, I will love you as long as, here's the expectation, as long as you do what I'm trying to tell you to do. I see where you're at. You're in this wicked place, and there's no way you're going to get out of it unless you listen to me. And I've been there. I've gotten out of it. Listen to me. And if you do that, then I'll love you. We're there too, aren't we? Especially with grandkids and kids, right? Just listen to me. But we've got to move beyond expectations and love unconditionally without expectations. Love as God loved. Aren't you thankful that God loves people who were stubborn, unchanging, stiff-necked is what the Bible says, didn't listen, never met his expectations, not willing to change, utterly lost and wanted to remain utterly lost, essentially. Aren't you glad that God looked upon them people, being us, and said, while still sinners, I love you. Amen? So our faith in Christ should push us to love abundantly more and more. But look at this next point. This is where I really want to hit home. This next point this morning, we are given a comforting hope through faith in Christ alone. I think this is the main theme through Paul's letter, and he's climaxing it here at the end of 1 Thessalonians, is the hope that we have in Christ. That there is a comforting hope. Look at chapter 4, verse 13 with me. If you're there, say amen. Chapter 4, verse 13, listen to this. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow or grieve as others who do not have hope. Listen to what he says, who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring him back. Bring back with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. Listen to this. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Now, listen to me, friends. These are some interesting words that you find here. They're interesting. They're challenging. They're confusing. What in the world is he talking about? The dead rising, archangels screaming? I mean, what in the world is being said here? And you come to this, and I'll tell you what's being said. Here's the bottom line, that we're talking about a glorious day here. We're talking about a glorious day. I don't want you to miss this. What he's talking about here is a day that we can hope in. That's the theme, hope, a comforting hope that we can have. We can hope in this glorious day, a day when Jesus will return. Y'all know Jesus will return, don't you? Don't you know that he will return, that he will? And it says here that the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout. Listen to this, that he will descend himself with a shout. This isn't some quiet, secret thing. He comes with a shout. And it says not only a shout, but the archangel. Listen to what it says, a voice of an archangel. I don't know if you know other parts of the scriptures, but you know what it says when angels are speaking? It's almost like a thunderous roar. So imagine this. Jesus is returning. It says that he comes with a shout. It says that the archangel, there's a voice of an archangel, thunderous noise. And then imagine the trumpet of God, it says. Now, I don't know if you know anybody that plays trumpets. If your grandkids do, bless your heart. They're loud instruments. They're loud. Imagine God's trumpet blowing. He says he'll descend himself. Praise God. Says that there'll be a voice of an archangel and there'll be a trumpet of God. Oh, it's glorious. But then it gets a little weird, doesn't it? It says that he'll bring with them those who have already died. Those with him he'll bring, it says. And then there's this idea of when he comes. So he descends himself, it says. But with him, who comes? Those that have already died that are in Christ. We know from Paul earlier in passages that it says that you're absent from the body. When a Christian, when one that is in Christ dies, you know what it says? You're absent from the body and what? Present with the Lord, right? You're absent from the body, present with the Lord. That's why we call it sleeping in a sense. That's why the language uses sleeping. When you see a Christian who has passed away in a coffin, in one sense, they're just sleeping. Why? Because of the hope that we have here, in which when Christ returns, it tells us that the dead will rise, that he comes with the souls of those that are in Christ, but then their bodies, their physical bodies, and ashes and all. I don't know how it's all going to work, but I know that the scriptures tell me when he comes that he'll bring with him the souls, and this cemetery over here, the ones that are in Christ, will raise, and their resurrected bodies will be united with their souls. They'll be with the Lord, and the ones that are here get to watch it. Hallelujah. That's right, brother. Imagine that for a moment. The fact that Jesus is returning, and he brings about resurrected bodies, but not only does he resurrect the dead, we too, if we are here, y'all know this pertains to us one way or another. If we're dying and we die and we're in Christ now and we return with him, or we're still here when he returns, who knows? I don't know when that'll be, but if we are, we're going to witness this event one way or another, church. And so when this happens, Not only are the dead raised, but we too will be resurrected in a sense. Our bodies will be raised. Where do you get that from? 1 Corinthians 15, verse 50. Now this I say, brethren, that the flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. What does that mean? Because we're sinful. The flesh is not, sin is not just things that we do wrong and disobey God. It's who we are after the fall. It cannot inherit the kingdom of God. It tells us that clearly. Nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. Please notice that word, a mystery, because I'm going to talk about that in a minute. We shall not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this incorruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying in which is written, death is swallowed up by victory. Then that should be said, death is swallowed up by victory. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast and immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor in the Lord does not go in vain. You know that when we labor for the Lord, it is not in vain because of this hope that we have, church. So what a glorious day that it's talking about here. But Paul's also going to talk about how it's not so glorious for those that don't know Christ. And he just mentions this, but he doesn't dwell on this because this is not his point. His point is the hope he's given believers. What does he say here? Look at chapter 5 with me. But concerning, he's talking about the day of the Lord here. But concerning the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you. For you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. For when they say peace and safety, when everything's going good, then sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should not overtake you as a thief. You are sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch, be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But you, let us, it says, verse 8, but let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet of the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. It's in this passage here, and the passage we just read a while ago, that I've asked you to pray for me, and asked for you to pray for yourself, because we must hear these words with caution. I really mean that this morning. Pray that the Lord would let you hear these with caution, because these exact verses in Scripture have led people, the church specifically, to be split in so many ways and to cause tension and argument and arrogance and pride in so many ways that it's disgusting if you want to know the truth about it. And so as we approach these, I want us to understand that the main point here we're going to get back to is the hope. The moment you start using these and diving into all kinds of speculation, I think we're in dangerous ground. Take the word of God for what it says. This is what it says. You can pair that up with Daniel. You can pair that up with Revelation. I don't have any problem with that. You can study that. It says, do not despise prophecy. You can study it and see how you think it's all going to come together. Praise the Lord. I believe God's going to use that. But in some extent, it tells us it is a mystery. And to some extent, I think it's to no avail. And what I mean by that is Jesus himself said, but that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels know. Only my Father in heaven knows that day. But we, my friends, have gotten so caught up on how exactly all this is going to happen. I truly believe this. We've got caught up on how all this is going to happen that we form all these theological camps. We talk about, well, that means pre-tribulation, or it means mid-tribulation, or it means post-tribulation. Meaning when the rapture happens, if it's going to happen before the struggles that it talks about in Revelation, or if it'll happen in the middle, or if it'll happen at the end. And the ones that think it's at the end believe that that's Christ's return, his actual second return. And so there's all kinds of thoughts that go out here. Millennialism, premillennialism, is Christ coming before the 1,000 years? Is he coming after the 1,000 years? Postmillennialism, is it amillennialism? Are we in the millennial right now and it's some kind of symbolic thing? You have all these camps that are out there. We got charts, maps, They show the exact timing of everything, but again, to some extent, no avail. Because Jesus himself says, not one of us know. Jesus himself says, not even the angels know. Only the Father knows. In fact, I think we've got to be so careful. Because my biggest fear, one of my biggest fears, is being like the Pharisees, who studied scripture and prophecy all of their life. Prophecy about the Messiah that is to come. Studied, that's what they devoted their whole life to. And they knew it. They read it. And they got so caught up and arrogant and prideful in the way that they thought it would all come to fulfillment when Jesus was standing right before them in the synagogue and he read the scroll that talked about him coming and he says, today this has been fulfilled. The Pharisees didn't even catch it. My fear is that we look at prophecy so tightly and get so wrapped up in our own arrogance and pride that we say this is exactly how it has to happen, that when it happens, it's almost as if we miss it just like the Pharisees. Now, you might say in some extent, we can't miss this. Well, I agree with you. I think in some extent when Christ returns, he's going to return, right? Whether that's post, mid, pre, I don't care when it is. I'm going with the Lord. Amen? I'll be with him always, it tells us. I want us to get this. Now, I'm not saying that you can't have your own convictions. I know specifically a lot of convictions are pre-trib, pre-millennialism. I know some of us in here don't think that. You can have your convictions. You can even call them convictions because you believe Word of God points you to that. But I believe there's enough room in there that we should not be prideful or arrogant and boast ourselves up to thinking we have it right and only we have it right. Amen? If you want to know a little bit more about it, read Matthew 24. Jesus talks the whole chapter about end times, about coming again. He talks all about it. And so read about it. Before, in fact, read Revelation. Read it. But before you go to Dr. Theologian Google, read God's Word. I mean that. Google will take you wherever you want to be taken. Go to His Word and see what His Word says, my friends. Go to His Word. And when you read it and you say, man, this is confusing. I really don't know what Daniel's talking about. I don't really know what John is seeing. I don't really know what Jesus is even saying. Welcome to the club. Amen? The scriptures itself in some way says it's a mystery. The scriptures in itself, when you read Revelation, there's things that they tell John in this vision. And then they tell John, don't you write that down, John. What are we supposed to do with that? Why? God is reserving some of it for his glory. That's all I know. And I'm okay with it. Are y'all okay with that? All right. So my point in all of this is, though, I don't think the eschatology, the fact of the end times, is the main point that Paul's getting at in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. The main point that he's getting at is hope, a comfort to believers that is suffering in a fallen world. Remember the persecution. He's showing them the unshakable hope that they have in Christ. And so listen to the way it started again. Verse 13. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow and as others who have no hope. For if we believe in Jesus and that he died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. He says, for this we say to you by the word of the Lord, there's authority there, that we who are alive or and remain until the coming of the Lord by no means precede those who are asleep. The Thessalonians were believing. That's the main point here. They were struggling because Christ was there for a few short weeks and he told them about, or Paul was there, excuse me, was there for a few short weeks. And then he tells them about Christ returning and then Paul gets ripped out of there. What happens to these believers? People that they love, brothers and sisters in Christ, are dying every day right before them. And they're concerned that they're going to miss this coming of the Lord because Paul said he's coming. So they're thinking, what about our brothers? Are they going to get to experience it? So Paul's main point here is, don't grieve like those who have no hope. He says, we have hope. We believe that Jesus died and he rose again and he's coming again. We have hope. The greatest hope in the world is this, that those who have died and are present with the Lord right now will return one day. And that we too will see it and that the bodies will raise and then that we too will be joined together in the heavens. Can you imagine us joined together in the air, in the midst of the clouds? That'll be the greatest family reunion there ever existed. Can you imagine that for a second? The beauty of being there. But even more so than that, the beauty of the Lord being with us. Now, exactly where this falls in, I don't want to get tied up on. I want you to understand with certainty that it will come. That this is God's hope for us. Paul says, I know you don't know when it'll come. It'll be like a thief in the night, like Jesus says. However, while the time is unexpected, the event is not. Praise the Lord. Then we get to the heart of the passage. But let us, verse 8, but let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. And then comfort one another with these words. So what does Paul say you should do in the meantime? He says, put on that breastplate of faith and love. Put on that helmet of hope, that hope that we have of our salvation. And then in verse 9, he explains that hope. He says, God did not appoint you to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus. This is one of the most precious verses in all of Scripture. God did not appoint you and does not appoint you to wrath if you're in Christ. He appoints you to obtain salvation. Now, I want you to hear me. I want you to get this beautiful truth this morning, church. If you're going through something, whether it's this virus has brought about anxiety and depression and struggles, whether it's isolation or whether you're fighting cancer, or another terminal illness and you're struggling with it, or whether you're just simply struggling with family members, whoever it is, whatever it is, if you're struggling with something, I want to give you hope this morning that that is not God's wrath against you. It is not God's wrath. He does not appoint us to his wrath. If you're in Christ, that's the point of Christ coming. That Christ, when he died on the cross, you remember those prayers beforehand. He said, may this cup pass before me, but your will, Lord. What is he talking about? The cup of wrath. When Jesus died on the cross, friends, he took every drop of the wrath that was against us that are in Christ. Every drop satisfied God's wrath. It's not a point. We're not appointed to his wrath. We're appointed to obtain salvation through the Lord. And so, there's beauty in this when we get to this verse, memorize that verse, and listen to what it says at the end. Who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with the Lord. This is the beautiful hope. Whether we're alive or asleep, we shall be with the Lord. Amen? God has given us the end of the story for hope. He's given us the end of the story for hope. He's given us hope. When your world is falling apart, church, when it's falling apart, everything around you is falling apart. God says, I've given you the end of the story. When it seems like no one's listening and he's not even hearing your prayers, he says, I've heard them. Look at the end of the story. He's saying Christ has conquered all. He's conquered death. He's conquered Satan. He's conquered sin in the world. He's conquered it all. If you are struggling and you're thinking everything's falling apart, he says, have hope. Look at the end of the story. Christ has victory. We sung about that, right? Oh, praise God. What a beautiful hope. Let me come to this third point this morning. What do we do with that hope? Because the love of God, we can place our faith in him, which produces a beautiful hope that causes, listen to what it causes, us to live out the will of God. So when you read these last verses, I've already read them, I'm not going to read them again, but what it is saying here is Paul saying, let me encourage you. As you live out this hope, let me encourage you what that should do to you. It should cause you to walk in obedience with the Lord. He says, first with the church. He says, to recognize and love those who in the church that labor among you. We should recognize and love those that labor among us. Your deacons, you should recognize and love them. They work hard for you and among you. For like when I go on vacation next week, Doyle is going to be the one that's on call. I mean, what a blessing that is. That is work that he's laboring among you. And I'm not saying that to glorify him, but to glorify Christ and what he's given us. Those Sunday school teachers that labor over and over to give you more meat of God's word, or those that serve our children, or those that are serving our community to show the love of Christ, recognize them and love them. And then those that are over you, talking about the pastors, love them, recognize them. How do you do that? Well, first off in prayer, and then keep peace among yourself. Amen. If y'all kept peace among yourself, my job would be easy. Keep peace among yourself. Be united in the Spirit. Yield to the Spirit. He says, second, practice discipline with one another. Comfort one another. Strengthen one another. Be patient toward one another. Pursue what is good between one another. He says, that's how you live in the church with this hope. But not only as a church, but individually. He says, rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all things. Yield to the Spirit. Do not quench the Spirit. Hold God's word. Hold to it. Don't despise prophecy. Fight for holiness by abstaining from every form of evil. Paul says this is the will of God. This is the will of God. But the most encouraging thing Paul gives is this very end point, and it's very brief. May you trust, point four, may you trust the faithful one who calls you, who also will sanctify you and make you blameless. Listen to his prayer at the very end, verse 23. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who calls you faithful, who calls you is faithful, who also will do it. Brethren, pray for us. Greet everyone with a holy kiss. I charge you by the Lord to read this epistle before all the holy brethren. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. The greatest comfort that Paul gives here is while he challenges, encourages them, and tells them, be obedient to the Lord. Have hope in the Lord, and they'll cause you to walk in obedience with me. He says, okay, guys, after you try your hardest and walk in that, the greatest comfort is it's never you in the first place that's going to do it, though. It's Christ himself that's going to sanctify you and make you blameless before the Father. Oh, praise the Lord for that. For who calls you is faithful, and who will do it? Do what? Sanctify you and make you blameless. The response today is simple, y'all. Response is simple today. Are you living out faith, hope, and love in your life? In Christ? Are you living out faith, love, and hope in Christ in your life? Or are you living out a shallow version of that in which you're trying to do that on your own? And it's apart from Christ. That's really my question this morning. Is it something you're doing in and of yourself, or is it something that Christ is doing in and through you? Because that makes all the change. He says it at the end, now may God sanctify you completely. May he do that. May he make you blameless, preserve you blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus. So I pray today that if you say, you know, I talk a lot about faith, hope, and love, but it's really in my power, it's really in my own doing, just kind of disguised with a sense of Christ, but not really the source of Christ. If that's you, would you ask the Lord to give you a new heart today? To change your heart, to put his faith and his love and his hope in you in such a way that transforms you and allows you to walk in obedience to him? Would you cry out for salvation today? If that's you, cry out to him. But if you're sitting here and you say, I'm saved. It's in Christ, but I struggle, but all that I know, it's in him. Would you just simply do this with me? Just glorify the Lord for a moment and think about his return and the hope that we have in that. Thank you, Jesus, right? In fact, I want you to play this song, Thank You, Jesus. And I want all of us to respond. If you want to come to the altar, you can. You want to come to me and pray with me, I'll pray with you. But I want every one of you to respond this morning. Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you and thank you, Lord. We love and thank you, Lord, and we ask for your mercy and grace to be upon us right now, God, as we worship and respond to you in the name of Christ. Amen.
The mystery of the cross I cannot comprehend. The agonies of Calvary. You, the perfect Holy One, crushed your Son, who drank the bitter cup reserved for me. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Thank you.
Praise God, church. I hope you leave just thanking Jesus. You know, we sung earlier, when Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. I pray that you would just praise him today as you leave and praise him this week. I love y'all. Looking forward to revival next week.